Welcome to Larry King Live from New York. Tonight, an evening with Dustin Hoffman. A quarter century after he stunned the movie world with The Graduate and Midnight Cowboy, one of our most powerful acting talents looks back on past successes and ahead to new challenges. Now, from New York, here's Larry King.
Good evening. Welcome to Larry King Live from New York tonight, an evening with Dustin Hoffman. A quarter century after he stunned the movie world with The Graduate and Midnight Cowboy, one of our most powerful acting talents is going to look back on past successes and ahead to new challenges. And it's a great pleasure to welcome to Larry King Live here in New York City, Dustin Hoffman. I thank you very much. You've taken some time off. Why? Hero was your last movie, right?
Almost 2 years ago.
Where you been?
I don't know.
I mean, what's going on? Let's start, Dustin. Two Jews, and we don't know where we are.
Okay. I guess I just wanted to develop my own projects and not just take acting jobs, so that somehow the material would closer reflect something I felt strongly about. The last experience I had like that was Rain Man, which was 1988. It's been too long since I've repeated an experience like that, where you start a project from the beginning.
So you decided that you would take time off until you found the right project?
No, I've been working on about four things, and they kind of creep along, and maybe one I can do in a couple of months if I get the draft.
Well, while you're working and it's creeping,
yeah,
do you miss the craft?
Yeah.
So what do you do?
I kind of act out on the street, you know, with my kids, you know.
I mean, you spend a lot of time with the kids, and you're, what do you do? What does an actor do when he's not acting?
Well, I am acting. I mean, when I'm working with a writer or working with on the research of it, in the sense that you're saying this is what the character should be like, and this was, so in a sense you're rehearsing the character. You know, you're saying, if you're the writer and you're writing this character that we're making a script out of, we try out different things, we improvise.
So even in early developmental stages, you're working.
You're rehearsing. The movies can't rehearse like a play. You know, in a play, you go in the theater, you have the lines, you rehearse for 4 weeks, and you open. In a movie, you start shooting, and that's it. There's no rehearsal. So this research time is rehearsal.
You've won all there is to win, gotten all the accolades there is to get.
No, not Olympic medal, Nobel Prizes.
what are goals now?
The same goals. In other words, to get closer to Ralph Richardson, great English actor, before he died, I think on his 80th birthday, they said, asked him a similar question. So I can't answer it as good as without quoting him. He said, what would you like to do? He said, I'd like to learn a little more about acting before it's too late. And I think that, you know, you never get close enough to what you want to do. As Bobby Duvall, my old roommate, says, closer to the bone.
Duvall was your roommate?
Yeah.
Where?
In New York for about 2-3 years.
The two of you, when you were, neither was well known.
I came to New York. I knew Gene Hackman from school in L.A. I stayed at his place. I was afraid to leave his apartment because New York scared me so much, and I just had $50, and it was a hot summertime. And I was supposed to be there for 2 days. I'm there for a month, and he can't get rid of me. I won't leave. He's got a one-room apartment with a wife. I'm sleeping on the floor in the refrigerator. I refused to. I said, I'm not going out there.
You were scared?
Yeah, I was very scared. So he says, I got this friend who's looking for an apartment. He's an unemployed actor, just like Gene, just like me. It was Bob Duvall. So he introduced us, we hit it off, and we roomed together.
Who got the first break, you or Bob?
Oh, Bobby. First Bobby, then Gene, then me. And neither of us ever, none of us, we would have laughed if you said that we were going to, you know, become famous or something. Because to us, making it was if we could work off-Broadway for the rest of our life and get roles.
You know who this is very similar to is Henry Fonda and Jimmy Stewart.
They were roommates?
Roomed together in New York, out of college, looking for work. They both got a couple of plays, and Fonda went to Hollywood, or Stewart went to Hollywood, then Fonda went to Hollywood.
Stewart was the first one.
Yeah. Your break came through, Gene, didn't he see you? Mike Nichols saw you in an off-Broadway play?
I don't think he did. I think somebody else did and told him about me, a play I was doing off-Broadway called A, English Farce. And he had been testing people for The Graduate for probably a year and a half. Tested everybody for my part, for Benjamin, and also for Catherine Ross's part. I think Catherine Ross, we tested together. I think we were the last people to test, and that's why we got the part. Because at that point, they looked at the rushes I heard of our tests, and they said, look, either we take these two or let's shelve the project. I think whoever would have tested last would have.
Did you have really any idea what that part would do for you?
No. In fact, after it opened, my agent called me and said, let me ask you something. Are you in the phone book? I said, sure. He said, you better change your phone number. I said, why? She says, because I think you're going to be a star now. So I changed my phone number, but of course you can't change your address, and I still live 31 West 11th. And I started to get visitors, you know, every day, and it was a shock.
Why, you didn't think the movie would be big? You didn't?
It was not considered to be successful when it was previewing, when it was in its, when it was after they had cut it. I was getting, there was word of mouth coming back that it was going to be an art house film, that they miscast the lead, meaning myself. If they would have had a good-looking guy, they would have had a shot. And they didn't expect it to. As a matter of fact, it didn't open big. It got good reviews, but it had a slow.
So you were prepared to go back to Broadway and off Broadway?
No, I went back to unemployment. While they were cutting the film, I was taking unemployment checks, going every week, and I continued to do that after it opened.
Graduate opened,
yeah.
And you were collecting unemployment?
Yes, for about 3 months, and then somebody from Life magazine found out about it, came down, shot me in line, embarrassed me, printed it in the paper, and I was so angry because I said, I'm not going down anymore, and I had no money.
Didn't you make a ton of money from The Graduate?
I made $17,000 gross, but I had to pay for my hotel in L.A., my apartment in New York, so I netted about $3,000.
That's all they paid you?
That was a lot of money to me. I had never made more than $3,000 in a year in my life. This was like, you know, five times the amount I'd ever made.
And now we're at the 25th anniversary of Midnight Cowboy. That was number what for you?
That movie was after The Graduate.
Right after?
Yeah.
How did that script come to you?
Well, I was getting scripts, and I was turning them down.
You were hot now.
Yeah. Anybody is hot that's in a hit. It doesn't even matter if it's a good movie. If it's a hit, you're hot. Even if you have a small part, it's like you're magical, you know?
Because people are paying money to see it.
Well, the studios somehow attach that kind of magic to you. Oh, so-and-so was in such and such a movie. That means the movie that they do for us is a hit.
You know? This is corporate think.
Yes. So I'm getting all these scripts, and they're not very good, and I'm turning them down, and I'm happy to go back to off-Broadway. I didn't have that great an experience making the film. It was hard for me. It was not something I enjoyed. It wasn't anybody's fault. It just wasn't like rehearsing for a play. It was you know, you don't see rushes. You don't have any sense of how you're doing. I thought, I'll go back to the theater. And then I got a call from my agent, a lovely woman who's since died, Jane Oliver, and she said, I got a book. I want you to read it. It's called Midnight Cowboy. So I read the book, and I thought, wow. And they said, you know, how'd you like to read for this? And I said, yes. And John Schlesinger heard about me through the producer, Jerry Hellman, and who had seen me in the off-Broadway play and suggested me. And Schlesinger said, no, that's a kid that's going to graduate. He's not right for this. He thought I was too good looking. In The Graduate, they thought I was not good looking. And now suddenly I'm too good looking for Ratso.
Wonderful business, isn't it? Was Voight cast right away, too?
No. Voight was not even the one they cast.
He was unknown, right?
Yes. Yeah. And he tested. There were three people that tested. He was one of them. Michael Sarrazin got the part. You know Michael Sarrazin?
Sure. What happened?
The studio that he was under contract with wouldn't let him out.
Such is life.
See that?
Now, that one, okay, The Graduate, you had no idea. Now you're a star.
Yeah.
You're doing this one. Nichols has directed you in The Graduate. The Graduate is a hit.
This is 1968.
Eight.
And you know how I know I'm a star? I'm walking down Fifth Avenue, and a girl comes up to me, as W.C. Fields said, bountifully endowed by the Creator, and she has a T-shirt on. This is the 60s. And she says, she recognizes me. She gives me a pen. She lifts up her T-shirt. She doesn't have a bra. She says, would you sign me?
You made it.
Yes, that was...
Did you sign?
Yes.
We'll be back with Dustin Hoffman. Midnight Cowboy is 25 years old. They re-released it. We'll talk about that and more.
I didn't dot the I.
Oh.
Sorry.
We'll be back with Hook after this.
They can't be trotting down to Times Square to pick out the merchandise. They gotta have some kind of middleman. And that's where old Daniel comes in, you know what I mean?
Hey! I'm walking here! Up yours, you son of a... Stop talking to me that way! Get out of here!
Don't worry about that. Actually, that ain't a bad way to pick up insurance, you know.